Mr. Tarou, in this video, we're going to do a couple of examples of finding the distance between a point and a graph, or a function, though a vertical line would not pass the function test, so I'm going to say a distance between a point and a line. The first example, we're going to be able to look at and just pretty much tell what the answer is, because I've given you a line which is vertical. Now, the same would be true if the line given was horizontal. You can really kind of just look at the graph and tell what the distance between the point and that line is. The second example is going to be dealing with an oblique line, which simply means it has an angle, it's not vertical or horizontal. And we're not going to be talking about this third scenario here, that would be involving a lot of use of calculus, but just to give you a purpose of learning this, at least we're not going to be doing any application problems, which this is just going to be algebraic examples. But this idea of being given a graph, or in this case a parabola, a function, and a point that's not on that function, finding the distance between a point and a function, like here a point and a line, is a concept that comes up repetitively through your math studies. It'd be coming up again. You'll be learning something cool about derivatives, which will tell you how to find the slope of a curve, and you'll find the slope of that curve, which is the slope of a tangent line. You might have studied tangent lines yet, I'm not sure. And we would be looking for this distance between the point out in space and a point on that function, such that this segment between the point on the function and this point out in space is got a perpendicular slope to the tangent line. Now, we're not studying calculus, this is only an algebra video, but this idea comes up over and over again, so there's a good reason to learn it. Let's focus on this one first. We have a vertical line. Now, vertical lines, well, you know, all graphs basically are consist of an infinite number of points, and when you move just up or down, it's only the y-coordinate that's changing. So this is 2, 0, 2, negative 1, 2, negative 2, 2, positive 1, 2, positive 2, 2, positive 3. So in a vertical line, the equation of a vertical line is just x equals a number. So this has the equation of x equals 2. Our point out in space is 5, 2. Okay, well, I've got a tape measure here, that's why that was in my hand. You know, how do I want to measure the distance between a point and a line? Or even a parabola for that matter. Well, let's see. I don't want to just run it off to, you know, the middle of nowhere. Think about how your mom or your dad or somebody, a sibling or someone taking care of you, measures your height on the wall, right? They make a mark and then they measure it perpendicular. You know, this point is not 13 inches away from this line. It's not 10 inches away from this line. It's, well, you know, we're going to find the unit of measure is in terms of my x and y axis, but at least the way I've drawn it, it's about, I don't know, 7.5 or 8 inches, depending on wherever I put the beginning of my tape measure on this dot. But the point is, you know, you want to measure in a perpendicular fashion. You want to find the closest distance, the true distance, between this point and this line, and that's going to be measured in a perpendicular fashion. So, if we have a vertical line of x equals 2, and I want to measure the distance, then I'm going to measure it horizontally, because a horizontal line has a slope which is 0, or 0 over 1, and a vertical line has a slope which is undefined, or just any amount of rise over 0. Point is, that is perpendicular. Now, horizontal and vertical distances, I can just, you know, count off. I am at the x-coordinate of 2. Now I moved once, I'm at the x-coordinate of 3, I moved again, I'm at the x-coordinate of 4, and then finally I'm at the x-coordinate of 5. So this distance between the point and the line is 5, the x-coordinate of this point, minus 2, which is equal to 3. So, that's it, right? That's a piece of cake, finding the distance between a point and line. Just look at the picture. I mean, how hard could it be? Well, at least as far as linear functions, we're about to find out. So here we have a line drawn about as straight as I can get it. It's a little wobbly there. It has got the equation of x minus 3y is equal to 6. And I've got a point in space, which is 2, 1. And I want to find out how far is that point from this line. And again, we want to measure this in a perpendicular fashion. So if I can guesstimate this as much as I possibly can with a drawing, I want to find the length of that orange line segment, the distance between the perpendicular distance, the shortest distance between the point 2, 1 and this line, x minus 3y is equal to 6. Well, this time I'm not going to just be able to simply look at the answer, or look at the drawing, excuse me, and come up with the answer. It's going to take some algebra, it's going to take some work. So what we're going to do is, we're going to find the equation of this line. Now, why do I want to find the equation of, well, actually not this line, this is only a segment, but I want to find the equation of the line that contains this segment. Well, why do I need to do that? Because I want to find the distance between the point and the line, right? I just said that like three times. Well, the distance formula is equal to the square root of x sub 2 minus x sub 1 squared plus y2 minus y1 squared. And the distance formula requires you to know two points, and we're only given one. So we need to find the point of intersection between the line that contains this orange segment and the line that is given. Finding the intersection between two lines, that's where that systems of linear equations comes from that I was telling you about. So I need to find the equation of a line which is perpendicular to the given line. So I need to look at that x minus 3, y is equal to 6, and manipulate it into a format that's easily identified, where I can look at it and easily identify the slope. Now I also drew the picture, but let's just say the picture wasn't drawn, and I can't see the slope is equal to 1 over 3. Well, I would take my equation, I would put it in slope-intercept form, that's how I like to do it anyway. So we're going to subtract both sides by x, and get negative 3y is equal to negative x plus 6. And now I'm going to divide everything by negative 3, and get, we'll just go this way, get y is equal to negative 1 divided by negative 3 is 1/3, x, positive 6 divided by negative 3 is negative 2. So now I've got my equation, which was given to me in standard form, in slope-intercept form, where I can see what the y-intercept is, b, and I can see what the slope is, which is what the coefficient of x is, the 1/3. This is y equals mx plus b, the slope-intercept form. And I can look at this now and see that my slope is equal to 1/3. Well, that's all fine and dandy, and I do need that number. And actually, that number is the only thing really at this point that I need from this equation, x minus 3y is equal to 6. Excuse the interruption there. Okay, so I want to find again the equation of the line that contains that orange segment. Now, that orange segment is perpendicular to the given line. The given line has a slope of 1/3, so the perpendicular slope is the opposite reciprocal of that white line. So I'm going to take the 1/3, I'm going to flip it and make it 3 over 1, or just write 3, because divided by 1 doesn't do anything. This has a positive slope and it's the opposite reciprocal, so it's negative 3. So there, I've got enough information, I have the minimum information that I need to write the equation of a line, a point and a slope. And I'm going to use point-slope form, which is y minus y sub 1 is equal to m times x minus x sub 1. This is what I like to use to write the equation of a line. We have y minus, the given point has a y value of 1, or y coordinate of 1. Our slope is negative 3. And then x minus the x coordinate of our point, which is equal to 2. We're going to distribute to get rid of parentheses. Y minus 1 is equal to negative 3x plus 6. Subtract 1 from both sides, or excuse me, it's already subtraction, add 1 to both sides. And we get y is equal to negative 3x plus 7. This line contains that orange segment. Now, I still don't have my second point to find the distance with. I just had the original 2, 1. So now we need to find the coordinates of this intersection point. And we're going to do that by setting up a systems of equations. The line containing the orange segment and the original line, which is, again, y is equal to 1/3 x minus 2. Now, I know if you're watching this video and you're in this area of your studies that you've learned how to solve linear systems with substitution and linear systems with linear combination. Honestly, a lot of times I prefer the linear combination method where you manipulate your equations so you have a set of opposite coefficients in front of one of your variables and you add them and make one of the variables disappear because, you know, when you add opposites you get zero and you can continue on. But these equations are both solved for y, and I don't care if they really are both solved for y. I only need one of my equations solved for one of, you know, a variable, one variable, and I'm really kind of set up to use substitution right off the bat. So we're going to solve this system of linear equations, and I keep saying linear because all my exponents are one, and hey, these are lines, right? Linear functions. So let's pick a blue chalk here. This equation is solved for y, so you know that 1/3 x minus 2, which is equal to y, is going to get plugged into the other equation for y. You know, that's the space where it gets put into. This is the substitution part of solving systems of linear functions with substitution. We get 1/3 x minus 2, and anytime you do substitution, you should wrap where that variable used to be with parentheses, and then plug in the expression from the other equation. In this particular case, there's nothing being multiplied to the y. It's not like 2y. There's nothing. There's no division. There's no exponent. So the parentheses are kind of overkill, but not a bad idea. So that 1/3 x minus 2 is equal to negative 3x plus 7. If you have fractions in your equation and they make you uncomfortable, and sometimes you mess up a little bit with your fractions, just remember that a fraction bar is nothing but division. So the opposite of division is multiplication. So if you have a fraction in your equation, they make you uncomfortable, you don't like them, you don't want that division in your equation, then do the opposite math operation and get rid of it. Let's go ahead and multiply. Since I already have the parentheses here, I'm going to leave those there, add a set over here, and I'm going to multiply both sides of the equation by 3 to cancel out that division of 3 and make it look, you know, like something that makes me feel a bit more comfortable. That's going to be equal to 3 times 1/3 is 3, times 1 is 3 over 3, which is 1, or the 3's cancel out, giving me 1x. 3 times negative 2 is negative 6. 3 times negative 3 is negative 9. And then 3 times 7 is 21. Okay, I'm trying to solve for x. I'm trying to find, you know, the x-coordinate of the point where the two lines intersect. So I need to have an x on both sides. I need to get them together. So I'm going to I'll move the 9 to make things positive. We're going to add 9x to both sides, giving us 1 times 9 is 10x, minus 6, just to show all the steps, equals 21. Undo, okay, with this x now we're trying to solve for, we have a minus 6. I want to get rid of that negative 6 by doing the opposite math operation. We're going to add both sides by 6. Undo that math operation of multiplication and divide both sides by 10 and get x is equal to 2.7. And now we get to the point where I'm going to have to start reverting my notes a little bit to finish this problem up. Both of these line segments are intersecting at the same point. Now I have the x-coordinate of the point, I need the y-coordinate. It doesn't matter, because they're intersecting at the same point, it doesn't matter if I put the 2.7 into the first either one of these linear functions is fine. I'm going to pick the one that at least doesn't have yet another fraction in it, and we're going to get y is equal to negative 3 times 2.7 plus 7, and that is equal to negative 3 times 2.7 plus 7 is equal to negative 1.1. So the intersection point of these two lines is equal to 2.7, negative 1.1. Now, before I erase the board and do the distance formula and figure out the actual answer to this question, let me just, you know, I try to draw this somewhat accurately. And, you know, are these points at least appearing to be reasonable from my sketch? 2.7 is somewhere between 2 and 3, and it does look like my intersection point is somewhere between 2 and 3. My y-coordinate is a little bit less than negative 1, and actually it seems like I'm quite far below negative 1, but this was on, I didn't use a ruler or graph paper, so at least my intersection point is between negative 1 and negative 2, so my answer seems reasonable. Now I finally have two points, the point of intersection, the given point, but I'm out of space, so let me get out of the way and get this board erased. Alrighty then. Point one, point two. So, let's do the distance is equal to the square root of, and you know, I said point one and point two, but let's just make sure we keep that notation as clear as possible and not accidentally put a number in the wrong spot. And, okay, well, if I said 1 and 2, I guess I'm going to do x of 2, which is 2.7, minus x of 1, which is equal to 2. I always use subtraction when I'm substituting in, like I said, especially with subtraction, I mean, I'll use those parentheses when I plug those numbers in to make sure I don't make any sign errors. And we got y sub 2, which is negative 1.1. Minus, I'm not using parentheses there, though it's really not a bad idea, simply because there's nothing else out front. You know, like if I had labeled these points in reverse, I would have had something minus that negative 1.1, and I'd have to remember that the negative from the formula and the negative from what I plugged in would cancel out, but actually I kind of really intended on showing that, but so I made my labels, so there you go. Y sub 2 minus y sub 1. Alright, that is going to come out to be the square root. 2.7 minus 2 is equal to 0.7. Plus negative 1.1 minus 1 is negative 2.1. Now I'll have to revert back to my notes again. Negative 0.7, excuse me, not negative, positive 0.7 squared is 0.49. Actually, well, yeah, I don't really need those parentheses anymore. Well, yeah, I'll keep them there for good measure. Plus, okay, make sure that when you are squaring negative numbers, there is a difference, remember, between negative 2 squared and negative 2 squared. And our 2 and 3 line scientific calculators and our graphing calculators will use the notation you put into it correctly. And they'll do that right after I get the phone. Alrighty, so negative 2 squared is negative 4, whereas negative 2 squared wrapped in the parentheses is negative 2 times negative 2, which is positive 4. Alright, this negative 2 squared without parentheses, you're only squaring the 2, not the negative out front, which is why the answer is negative 4. So again, careful use with your parentheses. Negative 2.1 squared is positive 4.41. And let's get this out of here. That comes out to be the square root of 4.9, and the square root of 4.9 is equal to 2.21 units. And that is the end of my example. And that's about as hard as these problems will get, unless, of course, you're getting into calculus, where you're finding, say, the distance between a point not on a parabola and a parabola itself. So I'm Mr. Taru.
Bam!
Go do your homework. Oh, by the way, if you want to see some of those calculus problems, it's called optimization, or they're optimization problems, and I'll have a video on that up shortly.